ideally being able to double and triple down when things do get tough.
I know, I agree. And it's, man, I call my own bullshit too, because I'm like, all right, I'm going to slow down a grind and get liquid. But at some point, when you grow brand, you fall in love with growing brand.
Of course.
Yeah. And you're just like, fuck. Like, it's doing everything.
You know, Gary always says, whoever holds their breath the longest wins. And I 100% believe every year that I don't monetize is exponentially bigger it will be when I do. You saw the daily bread. Here's the new recipe. You can expect to see more transparency. 5,000 six-figure earners is success to me. Giving the best of me my living legacy. Sweet girl.
I'm trying to eat an entire orange at once and talk to you, so she just like blew it out of her nose.
What? So, over the last 2 years, I've put out over 5,000 pieces of content. And now the strategy is certain content needs to live on certain platforms only. Is there a certain level that you have to get to be able to do that, so that you're not missing out on new followers finding the other content? Like, for example, I have a daily vlog and a weekly vlog and two podcasts. So we're looking at, does the weekly vlog only live on my website? Does the daily vlog only live on Instagram? That's my question. That's what everyone's telling me that I should do, but my thought is that's lazy. Why wouldn't you post it everywhere?
Yeah, I think creating friction for the end user is a huge mistake. It's why I... why? If people want to listen to me while they're running in podcast form, I'm going to give you audio. If you want to read, because you like reading, I'll give you LinkedIn and my website and Medium. If you like videos, I think people should put out as much content as humanly possible in as many places
everywhere.
As
possible.
As long as you can afford
But the exact same content. I mean, no. obviously native same, to the platform. But
to the best of your ability. I mean, look, I always talk about watch what I do, not what I say. Like, I have the same content platforms, but there'll be nuanced differences. The copy, maybe the thumbnail. Got it?
Yeah.
Context matters.
Little 1 minute teasers, go to Instagram to check out the full video.
Playing. But content is the gateway drug to every business opportunity.
I was reading these meditations by Mother Teresa, and literally her definition of love is giving without expectation of return. So
there
you are. When the correction happens, it's going to be the biggest opportunity there ever was on social media, because there's going to be some shakeout, and those people that are faking like they're that no longer can fake it and no longer have the ad spend to put behind it.
I fucking agree.
And
with that.
It's doubling and tripling down now, so that when this does happen, that you've got enough organic reach to be able to at least if you need to slow it down, you'll be able to increase on the organic, but ideally being able to double and triple down when things do get tough.
I know, I agree.
And it's, man,
I call my own bullshit too, because I'm like, all right, I'm going to slow down a grind and get liquid. But at some point, when you grow brand, you fall in love with growing brand.
Of course.
Yeah.
And you're just like, fuck. Like, it's doing everything.
You know, Gary always says, whoever holds their breath the longest wins. And I 100% believe every year that I don't monetize is exponentially bigger it will be when I do. I cannot wait for you to see some of the footage from today's event. A lot of good panel discussions, a lot of good Q&A. Had some really cool moments within the Q&A with GaryVee that I can't wait for you to see. A really, really cool moment that I didn't think was going to be able to happen, but was able to happen.
Last night I probably said 50 times, I don't know what's next, but I'm really good at, when I see it, going all in. If you told me
that we would be here 2.5 years later and there had been no significant app other than Pokemon Go around augmented reality, I would have been 100% wrong. Once Pokemon Go happened, I'm like, oh, there it is. It's happened. People, I mean, look at all those weird people running through the woods to pick up a virtual Pokemon, right? So I would have thought every IP, Marvel and Harry Potter and anything and everything would be in play. And here we are, you know, almost 3 full years later, and there's not been one significant hit since. So even sometimes when there is an indicator, it's a hair early.
Well, I think that's
an anomaly.
We create more content than we know what to do with, and over 5,000 pieces of content in the last 2 years. So what do you see as right now? So one of my vlogs, My Living Legacy, we're transitioning to calling it Our Living Legacy because I want the other 4 people on our media team to have a role in that.
Love
because
that.
They're incredible people. What is the current upside and what's the future upside you're looking for from your team GaryVee content?
To me, one thing I think that they're probably, you know, you should probably ask Caleb after this is open, like one thing I'll tell you is I don't suppress anything. Like I put them on, like, and you know, I mean, D-Rock probably gets 50 fucking job offers a day. Like I create a culture that is sticky because of who I am and what I'm willing to do. And my ambition for them is the same thing my ambitions are for my admins. I hope Caleb wins a fucking Academy Award if in the back of his mind he wants to be a great filmmaker, and at some point I'm gonna have so much fucking leverage in the world, right? Justin, who used to film me, who quit, called me yesterday, I talked to him yesterday, and he called me, he goes, you know what? I didn't get it when I was on your team. I come out and I'm documenting myself. Justin decided he was gonna be GaryVee, but he didn't realize all his content was selfish, and it clicked. So now he's starting a new series where it's like Humans of New York. He's gonna literally go up to random strangers, film them, and ask them for advice. And then he called me and said, hey, can you do one to give it value? I'm like, of course. What do I want? I want them to think that joining me was the greatest fucking decision of their lives, right? In the same way that I can impact people that I've never met from afar with content, imagine how they think I'm a much better guy than you guys do. Anybody who really, really knows, the people who think I'm the best guy are my assistants who have all the information about me, about everything. They see everything I do, exactly how I do. They know me better than my parents know me. They know exactly the things I do.
Have you thought about talking about the idea of so many people with videographers following them around now? To me, it's been the ultimate lesson in self-awareness because it sounds silly for someone to say like, oh, you're on camera, so you're a better person. I'm like, 100%, and it's transformed me into a better person.
In 2006, when I realized this was all gonna, you know, I was smart enough, intuitive enough to understand it all out, I fundamentally became a better person.
Yeah.
I say it all the time, I started Wine Library TV that morning when I told Eric Kastner to go to Best Buy to do QVC. And the second the camera came on, I decided to do Wine Spectator because I got scared, literally, I mean, you know how my brain works fast. I'm like, fuck, what if I go to a party and somebody gives me a glass of wine and says, what do you think? And I say, this is shit. And they're like, fuck you. You said it was 95 points. I'm like, I got scared. So then I was like, shit, I just have to say whatever it is. And, you know, it's fun to have my dad here. Like, it all makes sense now. But in 2006, and this is February 2006, so this is early 2006, for me to go out and make content, first of all, it was weird. I didn't make content. Second of all, for me to pan shit we sold made no fucking sense. Even Brandon, my best friend, who runs Wine Library with my dad, who believes in everything I do because he saw the craziest shit when I was a kid at baseball card shows where everybody made fun of me and then it all sold out, blindly believes in everything. Even he was a little weirded out with Wine, because you couldn't hide. It was just like, this is bad. We have like 15 cases downstairs. Like, what are we supposed to do with it? You know? Yes. By the way, on the whole camera thing, I saw a situation the other day where somebody was filming somebody, and somebody was filming the filmer.
I firmly believe that sometimes you gotta have the self-awareness and be like, dude, this is a perfect, I love this vision, but this wasn't the right vehicle. And so I had to let it go, and it felt like a loss. But then several years later, I got together with my business partners and I took everything that I learned from the incubator, from my experience in media and so forth, and we put together a fund and we said, you can do well and do good at the same time. And now it's a for-profit fund and we invest in these founders and now I'm taking equity. When they blow, I'm blowing with them. We're all getting rich. You know what I'm saying? But it's the same vision. It was just a different vehicle. And now in my career, again, I have wildly differentiated opportunities, and if you want those, you gotta do wildly different things. Wildly different things. And so I see you guys are engaged, and I appreciate that. And I hope that what's going through your mind is like, yo, how can I take what it is that I'm doing and just make it different? Because no one cares that you sell insurance. No one cared that I was cleaning people's underwear. Like, just no one cared. And it wasn't until I experienced doing something very different that I realized, wow, like, the value of that. You unlock things in a totally different way. And that's where the struggles you'll go through when you run it. You know, I don't know. You're going to deal with your own struggles. Everyone's got their situation. You have family, you have kids. Everyone's got short-term pressures that they're trying to take care of. But I promise you, my friends, that on the end of that, if you can endure through your hardest, toughest times when you're building this thing that's different, and you're in your head and you're like, what the fuck am I doing? And you're considering tapping out, and you say, no, I'm going to go back to doing it this way. If you can resist that and you can get to the other side, you will drastically change your career trajectory. So remember, don't be mass manufactured, be custom. That's my time with you guys. Thank you.
Not everyone is interesting. Not all content is industry. Interesting. Real estate as an industry is not always the most interesting.
Who says?
Oh, me.
Right. You're one fucking dude, Dick.
I know.
You don't get to say.
Fair enough.
Right?
But you say I do.
No, you do for you.
Right, right.
But not for the consumer.
True enough.
The end. This is a very important, you know, I'm jumping in and making a joke to make a very big point. Some people think it's really boring to watch men run into each other and play football. I think it's the most interesting shit in the world. Other people decide watching 6 episodes of Escaping R. Kelly is fucking fascinating. I do not. The audience gets to decide. So I keep telling people here, like, they're like, I'm not interesting. I'm like, the only thing you've got is that you're actually interesting because you're uniquely you. The biggest advantage everybody here has when it comes to this concept is their truth. But everybody tries to do what's the right thing to do, and they start to vanilla themselves.
So go deeper and deeper into content, as deep as I can get.
Correct, about anything, like, tripped today. Hurt my ankle. Host.
Thank you so much, guys.
Third comment's gonna be like, I fucking hurt my ankle too today. We're humans, guys. We're humans. I mean it. It's why reality TV won. Reality TV got shit on. Social media got shit on. The closer to the truth, the better. We like it. It's why we rubberneck. It's why we try to like sit and listen to other people's conversations. It's what we do. We're interested. And so we have to talk about more, you know?
Thank you.
You got it, brother.
Devin's Ryan from Hawaii. Hey, everybody. Thanks for having me. I think real estate is moving towards the Amazon, which means I think it takes way too long to buy a house. It should take... Here? Okay, got it. I think it takes 45 days to buy a house, sometimes 2 months. I really think you should be able to walk in, maybe on a Monday, you get your keys on a Friday, you're good to go, and I think that's where real estate's going to end up, maybe in 10, 20 years.
I would love to be on the front.
Yeah.
Let me tell you how.
Yeah.
Blockchain.
Blockchain. Yeah.
Blockchain.
Yeah.
That's what blockchain's going to do. When it's me and him, and none of you fuck faces get in the middle, I'm going to move in on fucking Fridays, and give me the keys on Friday. Fuck Monday.
Yeah, yeah. So well,
it's coming.
And I want to be on the front of it.
Good.
Thoughts?
Like, build apps on blockchain and wait 17 years for it to be at scale since you're young as fuck. You know, start putting out content around these thoughts as you're thinking them through. I mean, that's what I got for you. I mean, like, how are you practically going to be at the forefront of right now, tomorrow, making house purchases go from Friday to Monday?
I don't know.
You can't. There's too much infrastructure and too much logistics in the middle in the way the industry's structured right now. You don't have the leverage. Like, you don't, the tools are not in place yet.
Right.
Like, I want to go to Mars and eat a fruit. Cool. How? Mm-hmm. That's really, like, there's too many processes and state laws, and there's just too much shit right now. Yeah. We're going to need a human restructure. The last human restructure was called the internet.
it really is in the process of restructuring. Mm-hmm. The next one will be blockchain. Blockchain has the infrastructure to play out the dream that you have. You're gonna have to wait. Good news is, you're young.
Wait.
You'll see it.
All right.
But I think you should start talking about it. Mm-hmm. Podcast, content, things like that. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you.
The footage from tonight is gonna be absolutely incredible. It looks like there's gonna be a bunch of people coming out to Pilos Tacos. Shout out to Derek Gonzalez, the owner and good friend of mine. And we're gonna throw down tonight, and tomorrow is gonna be an absolute blast getting on the 103-foot yacht and creating some killer content and creating some greater relationships. So that's what it's all about. Hope you guys are enjoying this view.